Wedlow, and this is Televisionation. I'm really happy to have you all here. Of course, this is a show where we look at issues and topics of interest in the TV industry, and especially the people who are inventing that industry. We're looking for the TV visionaries, basically. So it can be tech, content, advertising, measurement, data, tracking, all of those fun things, ATSC 3.0, if you know what that means. So I am especially thrilled to speak to two people who I met the last year and a half to 2 years, and they come from a world that I used to be in. I'm still sort of in, sort of, but they have translated the theater to television in a really exciting and interesting way. And I felt that it would be a great way to discuss their platform, their background, and the niche SVOD business, because that is a really hot area for new development today. And welcome to Bonnie Comley and Stewart F. Lane from BroadwayHD. Bonnie, welcome to the show. I'm glad you're here.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having us.
Hey, and Tracy, Stewart. Glad to be here. Yeah, glad to be here.
Great. They are a husband and wife team, mom and pop, just like my husband. We run this business too. We're a mom and pop, so I know how that is. And it's great. It's great to work with your spouse. All right. So there, you guys have the longest bios on the planet, as we discussed before I started here. Both of you have won a lot of awards. You've had written books, produced shows, invested in theaters like the Palace. I saw, Stewart, you're an investor in the Palace Theater on Broadway.
I'm not just an investor. I own half of it.
Oh wow, that's great! I'm coming to your theater next time we're in town when COVID's over. And of course, Bonnie, you've won many awards. Let's see, there are 3 Tonys, an Olivier, a Drama Desk. It goes. You won one of our own awards. Both of you won our award this last year called the TVOT Leadership Award of our 2020 Individual Leadership in the Coronavirus Era for the work that you guys did last March 2020 when we were all began this lockdown, and you offered your content for free to people because what else is needed, right? Everybody needed something to sort of calm themselves down and relax and to find something comforting. So congratulations on all of these things. BroadwayHD has been around for about, I think, 6 years or so. So would love to hear a little bit more about why you decided to start this, because it's a huge undertaking going from sort of, producing straight theater, working in the community, to translating everything you know and do into a TV service. How did BroadwayHD germinate?
Well, Stu and I have been involved in what we call digital capture, which is the videotaping or filming of a stage play. So you go in and you shoot what's actually on the stage. And we've been involved with that. I mean, Stu started even before he met me. So the first one that he was involved with was the Will Rogers Follies back in 1993, I believe it was. It was running at the Palace Theater, and Japan Satellite Broadcast came in and decided that they wanted to do it for a pay-per-view in Japan. So that was really the first one that we were involved with. Then over the years, we were involved with, ones that we had been producing the stage version of, and then others that we had an opportunity to go and shoot something that we weren't involved with the stage version. And always over the years, there were different distribution platforms available for us. So it was really, as I said, the first one went to Japan Satellite Broadcast as a pay-per-view there in Japan. There was mostly PBS, there was DVD, the DVD market fell apart, then this sort of event cinema, came into play. We started getting involved with that. And then MTV, we did Legally Blonde with MTV. We did the Grease is the Word with CBS. So over the years, we were involved with this stage to screen content. And probably about 7 years ago, Stu and I sort of looked at each other, because every single time that we were involved with one of these, people were just so thrilled that we brought that show outside of the four walls of that theater. And they kept saying, oh my God, you should do this with everything. This is amazing. You know, but it was so hard to make money. We were always just clawing our way back just to break even with these things. And
that's the nature of the theater business, isn't it?
Yep. And so but this was a different part of the theater industry. And so we kind of looked at each other about 7 years ago and said, you know, these are really great and we love doing them. And we are so proud to be able to present them on different, you know, distribution outlets. But where's the business? And at that time, it was kind of, you know what, the whole world is going to streaming. So what would streaming look like? And we put together the shows that we had been involved in, which was probably about 10 of them at that time, and said, okay, 10 does not a streaming platform make. You know, how do we do this? So we started, you know, building the technology and then looking for other content. And basically what we did was that we aggregated all this similar content into one place. So just about 6 years ago, we were able to launch and we had just over 100 titles at that time, mostly plays because they're less expensive to produce. And now we are up over 350 full-length stage plays and musicals for our subscription service. And, you know, it's just going really well. Unfortunately, it's going, you know, we're one of the only businesses still standing after Broadway went down just a year ago. So that's the, you know, the bad news is like, where are you going to get content from next? But the vaccines are coming. The rest of the world is opening up. We're shooting stuff in Australia. We're doing more stuff in the UK. So it's just, I think the legacy that Broadway HD will leave behind is that we are the aggregator. There was no one destination for if you wanted to watch theater on a screen. And when Broadway HD launched, that's what we started to really build, was the destination, the, you know, where do fans go 24/7? You know, you don't have to wait for an 8 o'clock curtain. Here we are streaming, you know, whenever you're connected to the internet. So that's kind of the, you know, the how and the why. I'm sure I missed something. So Stu, do you have, what did I leave out?
I also want to point out for you, Stewart, that it's not just content about plays and plays and musicals. It's special reports called Curtain Time by Stewart Lane that I really started to enjoy. You know, he does this old series where he was commenting back in the day. I don't know when that was, 70s, 80s?
1995,
about the business of the theater at the time. And that I'd really recommend that. It's fascinating. Okay, anyway, Stewart, tell us a little bit more about what your role is and a little bit more about the platform. And I mean, I have like all of these categories. What's your role at Broadway HD? What's your passion?
As well, technically, I'm, you know, founder and co-founder and CEO. And as Bonnie was explaining, we kind of evolved this story. I've seen other people, other businesses try and start Broadway HD, trying that digital capture. But you know, the audience wasn't there for it. So whether it was the pay-per-view, digital market, cable TV, and even alternative content in the cinema, that wasn't enough to sustain Broadway. As we observed younger audiences enjoying the theater and how they watch their entertainment, this was a major pivoting point for us in really going forward with Broadway HD. This was an expanding audience. The young people, high school kids, college kids, were all interested in seeing theater, but what was their biggest challenge? That they couldn't afford the tickets once they were able to could afford to come to New York. So the idea of democratizing theater, allowing it to be affordable and accessible to a larger audience that was hungry for live theater was a big thing. Now, my contribution, besides Bonnie and I set up this whole website, is I'm the historian of the group. As you said, I did Curtain Time. That's funny you brought that up. I do a nice one-on-one with Nathan Lane, by the way. And I do one on with Cora Khan and the renovation of 42nd Street. I mean, we're talking history. But so I am actually the one who looks at the shows and says, you know, this is going to be very popular. This has got a good start. This has history to it. You mentioned Oklahoma. We have Hugh Jackman in Oklahoma, And it's terrific. You know, Wolverine singing and dancing to one of the greatest scores on Broadway. So that's exciting. And this goes whether it's a Shakespearean play or whether it's, you know, comedy. That's where, you know, I really bounce off our business manager, who tells me, Stu, this is not a highly rated show by people, but in terms of popularity, and we'll go back and forth, but it's quality stuff. It's got a lot going for it. And so this way we make a decision on whether we should go ahead and try and license or shoot these shows.
Did you digitally shoot that Oklahoma production? Because it's beautifully done. I was watching it on your service.
No, that was done by the, I think it was the National Theater in London.
You're right. That's right. Okay. You know, I wanted to read a list of all these categories because it clearly was somebody who was knowledgeable, you know, about the industry, yourself or however, whoever is in charge of this, but also someone who is mindful of what might drive content, what might drive click-through, right? And you have critically acclaimed, musicals, movies you love, laugh out loud, date night, family-friendly, trailblazers, documentaries, Shakespeare, concerts, ballets, performing arts. So there's a cornucopia of content on this site. It's not just Broadway, really. I mean, there are straight plays. There's the original Death of a Salesman with Lee J. Cobb, you know, you have so much content on there that I have not been able to see because, you know, I wasn't born, perhaps. I mean, you know, I mean, and you're absolutely right. It democratizes this experience because it allows people to see an American in Paris who, you know, if you weren't able to make it to New York when that was on stage, there's all kinds of stuff on there. There's stuff from the past. There's Pippin with Ben Vereen. I mean, if you really want to see it, a strange, interesting Bob Fosse dated piece, that's interesting. But anyway, there's a lot to see. I don't think you can exhaust your choices there. And of course the Cirque du Soleil, that's an interesting, inspired, great category of content. How did you rope the Cirque du Soleil into this?
Well, they were on Broadway. They were a Broadway show. They had one of the, I mean, they do sit downs, or they did when the world was, you know, going to live shows in Vegas, around the world, in New York, they had one. So, you know, it really is a Broadway brand as well as being a global brand. And they're just magnificent. We approach them to license because they want the control of, you know, shooting all their own show, and just they want it to be exactly what they want. And so we just approached them and said, you know, this is what we're doing. We love it. You know, we would be honored to have it. And it does really well because it is a global brand. It is an international, crowd pleaser. Those shows are just amazing. But to the other, you know, genres of content that we have here in COVID, we've actually opened up new categories because, you know, Broadway fans are terribly underserved at the moment. There just are no shows around the world. I hope that all of this opens back up. But it's not going to be 41 theaters just, you know, as quick as they went down last March in 2020. They're not going to all of a sudden turn the lights on and 41 theaters are going to pop open in New York City again. It will layer, it will come in. It's going to be a little bit more gradual. The shows might look a little bit different to start. So we are really experimenting, and the internet is a great place to experiment. You can experiment in real time. So we started even before COVID with, Cirque du Soleil isn't what you traditionally think of as a Broadway show. You also mentioned An American in Paris, which when you look at it, it was a Broadway show. It was a Tony nominated show, but it's not, in some ways, what a traditional, you know, some people think of as a traditional show. It's very ballet heavy. And I don't mean that in a negative way. I mean that in a, you know, it's an elevated art form kind of a way. So we were able to, in real time, you put this content out to see, is this what your subscribers are looking for? And we found that, yes, indeed, they are. Some of the movie musicals that we've been adding, it was like, well, you know, we really are about the digital capture, which is shooting what's on a stage. But is our audience up for some of these, you know, movies that were plays or, you know, musicals on Broadway originally. And we're finding that, you know, with the right shows, yeah, they absolutely are. You know, this is what they're interested in. So yeah. It's fascinating. And the same with the ballet, the more recognizable names around Christmas. We have, you know, the Nutcracker, which is a ballet, and it is watched by families. It is watched over and over again, you know, because having a streaming service, you can see, and you're like watching these people like, didn't they just watch this? Oh, they're watching it again, you know, because they're so well done.
I love the fact that you're doing on movie musicals as well, because there's such a huge amount of interesting work that's done out there. And I know tomorrow, I believe on the 21st, we're recording it on the 20th today, you are releasing one of my favorite little musicals that was on TV. That was Rodgers and Hammerstein's Cinderella with Leslie Ann Warren, even though the sets are so strange, but I love that. I love that show. Anyway, sorry, Stuart. I was just going to say that,
you know, BroadwayHD is a global platform. So when you deal certainly with international entertainment like Cirque du Soleil or even Riverdance that we have, you're dealing with shows that play on a global scale. And those are things that help reflect what BroadwayHD has to do. So we're in the UK. We are in over 173 countries now that you can actually catch BroadwayHD on your laptop or cell phone or computer.
I actually just bought a subscription for my great aunt-in-law. That's a word. My husband's aunt. I'm not sure she's great, but she immediately clicked on 42nd Street. She was thrilled. But anyway, let's talk a little bit about the platform, because I know everybody who's watching this are in the TV business. Well, maybe it'll be all kinds of people, right? But we want a little bit about certain business things, like why did you decide to go with the SVOD model versus an AVOD model, right? Advertising VOD. And also, what platform are you using? Did you have someone to help you? I think Tom Kinney was involved somehow. I'd kind of like to know about the nuts and bolts about how you figured out as theater people, like, how do you put a streaming service together?
Well, our first, it was sort of like the prototype, if you will. So just about 7 years ago, we started building this prototype. We had, you know, as I said, we had 10 pieces of full length, you know, content that we wanted, that we'd started going out and gathering more. But, you know, in order to build any sort of, I mean, I'm not sure how technology, you know, whatever you want to get into it, but, you know, it's that, you know, how do you host the videos that are going to be this content that is as rock solid as you can? And so we kind of bespoke built something with a company called Tilson. And we, you know, we were kind of at that time saying, you know what, this is really different. We're going to have less. We're thinking that we want to do these curated pieces, but we might want to attach intros or, you know, not so much a behind the scenes, but an explanation of, you know, composers or playwrights, you know, and we put that in front of our shows to start with. And a lot of people were just like, can you get that off of there? Because I just want to get to the show. I don't really need the history. I don't need to like know who wrote it. I'm not really interested in that composer, you know, or I'll go Google it if that's what I want. So it was, you know, building it bespoke. And then about 2 years ago, you know, we started looking at everything. So there's like the technology, there's the hosting part for the content, then there's the payment collection. And then there's the part of your website that interfaces with, the consumers. And I think that, you know, we had all of that pretty much custom built. But then as we started to expand, everything being bespoke was like, oh crap, this is just like too much, too heavy. You know, we don't, you know, there's all these other streaming platforms that are out there that have way more content. You know, what are they doing? And that's kind of when we started to, you know, when Tom Kinney, who's our VP of operations and you know, our technology team came in and said, you know what, there's other stuff that's already out there that'll be fine. So we have now, 24i and Kling. That's working really well. When we launched, we really, you know, with our spend, we were trying to be lean and mean. And we thought, you know, we're only going to advertise where we think the theater people are. So, and we're only going to do, English speaking and US. And within like 5 days of launching, we had people reaching out through customer service to say, you know, I'm trying to watch your shows, but you don't, you know, you don't take my currency, you know? So it was like, wait a minute. You know? So there was these things that, you know, we were driven by consumer, you know, demand basically that had us pivot with things. And, you know, from payment collection to, you know, how things, how the videos are hosted, you know, that you really need them to be, you know, I mean, if they want to pirate something, they're going to pirate it, you know, whether it's Netflix or Amazon Prime or whatever, you know, they'll get to it. But it's easier to go get it off of another platform that just doesn't have all the security built into it. So they'll go look someplace else, I think is the, you know, the answer to the security piece. So, I mean, we kind of put things together and then we had a prototype. And 5 years ago, we said, you know what, we know we have something that works. We have content that people want. And here, you know, now what's the next level? Let's take us up to the next level. And yeah, that was Clang and 24i.
One of the most challenging things that we had to face on top of that was how to market this to an audience. You know, the theater going audience, and I've been producing Broadway shows for 40 years now, they're very loyal and they see many shows. They don't just see one a season. And we knew exactly where to find them. I mean, once we've got past the, oh, there are so many 100 million subscribers out there in the world, where's our audience? And those were the theater websites, the people who buy tickets to the theater, the people who are out in Cincinnati and Cleveland and Chicago, who love regional theater, love touring companies. So we were able to use the social network and the social marketing to target our audience specifically. So we didn't waste a lot of money on just gunshotting it, on shotgunning it, but actually specific audiences.
And did you hire a social media agency to do that? Or how did you do that?
We started off by having it outsourced, and then we figured, you know, we knew how to do it. And so now we're at another inflection point where I think we're looking at exactly that of like, okay, we've been doing it in-house for probably 2.5 years again. So it was out with somebody else that, and, you know, or a couple somebody else's, and then we brought it in, and now we're looking for like, you know, so if you're everybody out there, you know, we're actually looking for some marketing help, I think.
You know, because it's a new industry, people didn't know how to market this sort of thing. It's brand new. Where do you find them? Where do you spend it? You know, there aren't publications anymore. Paper is dead. Magazines are gone. It's all digital. It's network. And we're a digital company. So we want to sell what we have in a digital medium, so people can find us and then subscribe right away without having to go memorize a code or anything else. So it's been a real challenging thing because we're the pioneers. We're setting the standard. And so far we've done pretty well.
How are you rising to the surface inside these huge aggregators like, you know, Prime, you know, or where anybody could find your app, you know, on Apple TV. I'm not even sure it's available on Apple TV.
We have pretty much everything. Roku, Apple TV, like all of it. We have apps for everything. And, you know, I mean, I think that, you know, the sad reality right now is that we're one of the only functioning Broadway entities for a year. So the more people search for anything Broadway, we just keep rising up, you know, organically in the marketing. And it's, you know, it's working out well for us, but it's sad for the rest of the industry because there's still no reopening date. You know, it's heartbreaking. It's just heartbreaking because we are, you know, Stu and I, as you mentioned, with our backgrounds, we've produced for the live stage. Stu owns a theater. So, you know, these are just in New York, there's 100,000 people that are out of work for going on a year with no end to this in sight. You know, and even if we get some sort of government aid, it's, you, these people are artists, they're craftspeople, they've lost their sense of purpose. You know, they're not performing anymore. And what could be more tragic than to be, you know, a talented performer and have no place to perform? You know, that part of it just is it just kills me. It's so heartbreaking to see all of our colleagues be in this, you know, in this pandemic lockdown state. But that said, we're trying to support as much as we can, and we're really keeping everyone, you know, keeping the spirit of Broadway alive, because although the digital is never going to be a replacement for live performance, we're a wonderful alternative. And that's how we were basically, you know, from our DNA from the beginning was not to replace theater, but to be additive to the business.